The array of laptops we lined up to take a look at NVIDIA's new Super RTX mobile GPUs didn't make it in time because of a little global pandemic. So, new plan. Gigabyte sponsored this video to show off the Aorus 15G, an all-new design from them that they claim is the gaming notebook redefined. But for us, it also happens to house a brand new 10th gen CPU from Intel and a shiny new RTX Super GPU from NVIDIA. So we're gonna use it to take a closer look at Intel's claims about how much faster 10th gen designs will be compared to gaming laptops from 3 years ago. Have CPUs really gotten that much faster? Or is something else at play here? Spoiler alert, it's something else. When questioned, Intel acknowledged that the comparison to three-year-old laptops was not really apples to apples. And while we have gone from 7th gen all the way to 10th gen mobile CPUs, a big chunk of that performance is coming from the graphics card improvements in that time. But that doesn't mean that both sides aren't contributing here. The brains of our unit is an Intel Core i7-10875H. Now, as far as we can tell, it's pretty much just a refined 9th gen chip with slightly higher clocks. But guys, a laptop with 8 CPU cores that can boost up to 2 of them to 5.1 GHz is nothing to sneeze at. It's now faster than anything you could have bought for your mainstream desktop 3 years ago, let alone something you could have got in a laptop. The improvement over last gen is pretty incremental though, so I can see why Intel compared to a laptop from 3 years ago in their slides. Our new i7 seems to have marginally better single-threaded performance than our 9th gen i9, and actually ends up losing slightly in multi-threaded applications. If we're gonna see big improvements in CPU performance over last gen, it looks like it's up to the laptop manufacturers to throw some seriously thick thermal and power delivery solutions at the 10th gen designs. There are two main areas that the new 10th gen CPUs might help with gaming performance though. The first is thermal velocity boost, or TVB, originally introduced in Coffee Lake H. TVB has existed recently in desktop chips, but it was actually disabled by default, and it's probably best known for the multi-core enhancement fiasco a year ago when ASUS motherboards that enabled it by default performed much better than their real default counterparts. Well, now this feature is available on almost every 10th gen mobile chip and is probably what helped our i7 beat the old i9 in single-threaded tasks. The second area the 10th gen processor will help improve gaming performance in is by including 16 PCI Express lanes for the graphics card. This is actually the first time ever that laptop GPUs are going to be getting a full 16x interface to play with instead of the 8 lanes that they're accustomed to. How much of a difference will that make in the real world? Probably not a whole lot outside of some specific professional workloads, but it is nice to see nonetheless. Now, let's talk Super. The 2070 Super in the Aorus 15G gets 256 more CUDA cores than its non-Super cousin. And as for the clock speed, well, as usual, that's gonna depend largely on the laptop manufacturer, since on mobile, the amount of power and cooling available actually makes a much bigger difference to how fast the GPU will go than NVIDIA's spec sheet does. Maybe the most interesting feature of the Super mobile GPUs is the inclusion of Dynamic Boost, which balances the load between the CPU and GPU based on the task. So here's how the concept works. Let's say some laptop X has 140 watts of cooling available, with a CPU that can draw up to 70 watts and a GPU that could draw up to 100. Clearly, 170 watts is greater than 140. But for most situations, that doesn't really matter because there are very few workloads where a CPU and a GPU would both be fully utilized at exactly the same time. So say in a visually demanding game like Shadow of the Tomb Raider, the GPU is gonna get its full 100 watts of power while the CPU jogs along at 40 watts or so, and everyone stays nice and cool while you get the most FPS out of your game. Then you go and boot up CSGO. You're a pro and you need at least 400 FPS to hit your leap flick shots. Well, your CPU is gonna pin it at 5 gigahertz while your GPU takes a nap in the shade. It's up to manufacturers though to make sure that there's enough power available to take advantage of this. So Gigabyte has enabled this by including a 230 watt power adapter to drive the CPU and GPU at over 170 watts combined. These power management improvements, by the way, will work with both Intel and AMD CPUs, which is excellent, in theory. Now, let's take a look at the real world. In practice, our RTX 2070 Super was able to net us about a 10 to 15% performance improvement in games compared to a similar class non-Super laptop. Nice. Of course, in most situations, a desktop RTX 2070 Super will beat it in battle, but surprisingly, in Rainbow Six Siege, the Aorus 15G actually pulled off a W against our i9-9900K equipped desktop. Now, I'm certain that if we took the time to overclock the 9900K, or even just enable multi-core enhancement, it should win. But it does go to show you just how much performance is being strangled out of these mobile chips these days. Impressively, the Aorus 15G was able to put up these numbers without us having to apply a turbo profile or anything like that. Gigabyte has employed Microsoft's Azure AI to automatically switch between power profiles that optimize for power and cooling in a heavy task, quiet during lighter loads, and then extended battery while on the go. Another feature of this super GPU update is Advanced Optimus. OG Optimus was designed to switch between a powerful NVIDIA GPU for gaming and an efficient onboard GPU for lighter tasks, but it had some drawbacks. Neither G-Sync nor high refresh rate displays could use it. Well, Advanced Optimus apparently fixes those issues, and while the Aorus 15G here isn't equipped with G-Sync, so we couldn't test that, it was able to get 7 hours on battery while its display was refreshing itself 240 times per second. Quite impressive. Although some of this is probably due to Gigabyte including a massive 94 watt hour battery. Gigabyte claims it's possible to get over 8 hours of battery life, and if you were to turn down the refresh rate, that actually seems very attainable. Now, let's take a closer look at the star of today's show. The styling of the Aorus 15G strongly reminds me of the Civic Type R, with its spoiler-like accents and heaps of venting dedicated to airflow. For a gaming laptop, it's still a little, well, gamery, but if it's too much for you, the Aero lineup will greet you with open arms. It sports very solid I/O with three Type A's, Thunderbolt, Gigabit Ethernet, and a full-sized UHS to SD reader, and Gigabyte seems especially proud of the fact that you can connect three 4K displays via the full-size HDMI, mini display port, and Thunderbolt port. I mean, given there's a 240 Hz panel with Pantone calibration already attached to it, most people probably won't bother buying something separate unless they're trying to get some work done in between gaming sessions. But hey, it's there. The most interesting part of the Aorus 15G has got to be its fully mechanical keyboard though, with slim, clicky Omron switches. Now, if I'm being honest, this keyboard broke my brain a little bit when I first started using it, because you do have to use it kind of more like a real desktop keyboard. This does mean that you'll be giving up some of the fun tricks of more traditionally cramped laptop keyboards where the keycaps are right next to each other, like quickly swiping across adjacent keys. But the extra travel and the clickiness did lead to a definite increase in typing accuracy once I got used to it. In many ways, you could see it as the complete opposite of Apple's butterfly switches. Apple's are bursty and quick, perfect for sending IMs, whereas these are a much more deliberate feel, like I'm sitting down to start a thesis. Now, given they're made by Omron and rated for 15 million presses, they should hopefully also be the opposite of Apple's for reliability too. Zing. As for the pricing, NVIDIA surprisingly didn't adjust their Super lineup upward. So the RTX 2070 model of the Aorus 15G comes in at $2,000, while the 2070 Super version is $2,200. So it gets a better GPU and an upgrade to Windows 10 Pro. What this basically means is that the RTX 2070 Super is occupying roughly the same price as the old RTX 2070. The 2070 is actually about the price of an old 2060, and the new 2060, which is faster than the old 2060, but lacks Super branding for some reason, is looking quite compelling at a price similar to the old 1660 Ti. Basically, if you're looking for a new gaming laptop, you're gonna be getting a bit more bang for your buck than you would have a couple months ago, which is awesome. And you know what else is awesome? Gigabyte. Thank you for sponsoring this video, and especially managing to get a laptop in our hands, at least close to the NVIDIA Super Mobile launch. So thank you guys for that, and you can check them out at the link in the video description. If you're looking for another video to watch, maybe check out our original Super coverage. There you go. How much better are Super GPUs? Now you'll know for sure.